Okay, so I'll start up. I've got an optional section that I sometimes cover. Don't always cover this, but I think I can cover it in a fairly short amount of time, and I think hopefully you'll find it interesting. So we've been looking so far at some of the bog standard data science sort of thing. So you'll often see regression, you'll often see classification and clustering, which we're going to do classification next. But I thought I'd just pause because often find that people are just sort of jumping straight to those particular common use cases and not looking at in the broader computer science area at all the different techniques and algorithms and things that are available. So this is just looking at optimization. And it's something that crops up often. It's not maybe traditional data science. It's not seen as a super core part of that, but it crops up often enough that I think it's worthwhile just to briefly look at. So this is just having a look at some of the things that are possible and a few options that are there. So first thing I wanted to look at is a thing called constraint programming. And constraint programming is trying to find a way to solve things without you having to program at all. So if I'm trying to work out how to, if I've got some crayons, I'm going to do a color in a map of a country, and I want no two states to have the same color because it'll then become difficult to distinguish where the border is. How many colors am I going to need and what colors should I put everywhere? So that's the kind of thing that a constraint programming problem is going to try to solve. There's a bunch of different ways to do that and a bunch of times when this sort of crops up. I'm just going to show you some code to do this sort of thing. And the main reason why I'm going to show you this is because it's where it shows where how nicely Groovy sort of fits with the Python programming world. So this is one of the reasons why we're seeing a little bit of growth in Groovy for data science is because how it's got similar sort of characteristics as Python. So this is some Python code to solve. I'm going to try to solve send plus more equals money as it's a sort of a crypto-arithmetic problem. What I want to do is put a number for each letter. And because the letter E appears on both all three lines, it would have to be the same number in all of those spots. And N appears twice, M appears twice, zero, letter O appears twice. I'd need the same digit to replace each letter. And so I can do that with brute force. And I'd just sort of run through, I'd assume that I don't have zero at the front because it wouldn't normally, if I've got the number 42, I wouldn't normally go 0042 or something. So I'll assume S and M are between 1 and 10. And the others are between 0 and 10. And I can just brute force it out, and that'll come out with the answer. So that's the answer down the bottom. Nothing too magical about that. That's just some code, fairly straight, laborious code. Well, it turns out the Groovy version is very, very similar to the Python version in terms of how you would do that. But both Python and Groovy have got smarter ways to do it, and they both have very, very similar smarter ways to do it as well. And if, in fact, if you, instead of having to do it all by hand, if you, a constraint programming engine, it's, if you've ever, everyone's heard of a thing called Prolog or there's other things that solve bin packing problems and timetabling problems and so on. These are engines that calculate these sorts of things. There's things that do this sort of thing for you automatically. So you just tell it all the constraints and it goes and works out all the details. And so you can specify all the constraints, and it turns out the Python code for using one of these special libraries, again, is similar sort of complexity as the Groovy code. So this is using a particular library, Troco, which is good at solving these sorts of problems. So that's just a sort of a bit of interlude. But you don't even need Python or Groovy code for some of these sorts of problems. So suppose I'm trying to come up with the perfect diet. I'm in lockdown, I'm eating too many calories or whatever. So I'm coming up with my, I want a diet, I want to have at least 300 calories and I want no more than 10 grams of protein, et cetera, et cetera. And I've got things that I can go buy at the shop or get delivered, bread, milk, cheese, potato, whatever. What's the best combination of all those things that'll satisfy my diet restrictions here? Well, I can just go and dive into Excel and feed all the numbers in of, you know, what milk will give me in terms of costs and protein and whatever. And I can, Excel's got a solver feature. I just dive into the solver feature, feed in some of the constraints, feed in the grid where my data is, and ask it to go solve it, and it'll go and solve that for me. And it's going to come up with the answers. There's the answers there in the green. Or I can dive on to Google Sheets and it's got the same sort of solving capabilities. I don't need no Python or no Groovy to do this, but I can do it in Python or Groovy as well. And so there's doing the exact same thing with Ojelgo, Choco, a bunch of other libraries that can solve that problem. Apache Commons Maths can do it as well. There's variants of this that work. Some work with integers, some work with floats and things. There's some slight differences in how some of these different libraries work, but they're all achieving the same thing. And the fact that I've gone and put it into code means that I can now, you know, I'm building up a toolkit of stuff that's good at pulling in data from a whole lot of different places. And now I can put this in code. I can easily mix and match this code with all sorts of different data. I don't need to be popping up an Excel spreadsheet every day, putting in different numbers and hitting a button and seeing what pops out. I can just have my code there that sits there, gets today's data and just automatically pops out the answers. So these kind of optimizations, they're going to tell me the best combination of all these things to do are easy enough to do in code or in other tools. And there's some examples of that. Showed it using SAS as well, because it's got a way to call out to Groovy procedures as well. So that's the thing that it's calling out to and how it looks. So this is a payware thing, but even payware can call into Groovy and then you get the results coming up here, solving it using Groovy. Okay, so that was just a quick interlude. There is a very small example of a problem that you can run for that, but I want to jump over to classification now because this is probably this is more a traditional data science problem that people are going to be interested in doing. When I break to give you an example, let you run the classification examples. So anyone who's joined late and is trying to make head or tails of where some of these labs are. If you go to the Groovy track agenda, you'll see some links to a GitHub repo and some slides. You can either download, you can clone the GitHub repo and you'll have all the code and you can run stuff locally. Or on the GitHub repo page, there's links to Jupyter notebooks. You can just click on those links and all this stuff will run in your browser. The ones that I've got there, you can run in the browser. So there will actually be an optimization example you can run. And if you're interested in running that, when I pause to let you run the classification example, there's one of those there as well, then you can run both. Okay, so we're swapping to back to more mainstream data science now. We're going to do classification. And rather than grouping things into clusters, it's not unrelated, but we're just trying to predict some class. Okay, so typically, again, except I've spelled diagnosis incorrectly, so I've diagnosed the spelling of that word poorly with my spelling checker classification algorithm. But again, for certain sort of image recognition problems, certain kind of speech recognition problems, this is a good example. OK, Okay. So in when you're trying to classify things, there are some standard algorithms that you can be using. You can be using things like neural networks as well, or often you'll be using things like pre-canned classifiers. And that's what we're doing in this example. This is one of the examples that you've got on your, I think this is one of the ones in the notebook as well. I think it might be the one or a slight variation of that. I'm not sure. So here, again, there's been a whole lot of data used to make up a model. Like we saw with the regression, we had some data that we used to train up a model, and then we used it for prediction. That's the same process that's happened here. I'm not showing you the training part of that process. This particular set of libraries has got a pre-canned one of those that it's pulling in. That's the URL that's on that slide. It's going to pull in the pre-canned data for language detection. And we're just going to feed in some data and we're going to use it to predict. So that's what that particular example does there. Now, if you're trying to build up the data, then there's a whole bunch of different techniques that you can use. And one of them is neural networks. And that's where you let it's sort of like an artificial intelligence sort of thing. You let a bunch of little nodes that do very, very simple things, but are grouped in smart ways, often in layers, work out different things. So if you might work, if you're watching these slides, then your brain is getting a whole lot of different input and you'll see different colors. You'll hear my noise. You might hear some background noise for that might be occurring in near where you're residing at this point in time. And there'll be a whole bunch of different information that's coming in, and your brain will be processing that, and it'll give different weights to stuff that it thinks are important. So maybe you'll block out the tick, tick, ticking noise of a clock that's nearby, or creaking noise. My chair keeps creaking and I keep noticing that. But your brain will be putting certain things it'll be giving a high weight to, and other things it'll be giving a low weight to. And that'll it'll be in a multi-layered thing, because if you see a flash of light and you hear a sound all at the same time, that might trigger a pathway where different weights in this model both trigger at once, and you'll think, oh, is a lightning bolt about to hit me or something. You'll trigger off a whole bunch of different things there. So that's how your brain works, and that you're going to build software that's going to work that same way, and then you're going to train it up by feeding in a whole bunch of data or telling it this is what you should end up with, and it'll work out what the weights are, and then you use that. You then try to predict using that all of those pre-canned weights that have been fed in. So you feed in some new data, and it's going to classify what came in, and it's going to say that's a number, that's a letter, whatever it might be. And here's an example of the same sort of thing. Now you've got the code here for training it up and modeling it. There seems to be quite a bunch of code there, and there is a little bit, but it's actually it's the full thing for everything done by hand. Or there's ways to have pre-canned versions of this. So all of that code on all of these slides using Apache Commons math with a multi-layered neural network that I'm coding by hand. Okay, it's inspired by someone else's, I don't know if that was the link there or whether that's just the data. It'll be in the GitHub repo if there's a URL to go look at. Then we've got some data there. Actually, no, that is using the pre-canned data. Oh, no, that's my images. Sorry, I'm training it up using pre-canned images, and that's going to get my model. I'm going to then write that out, and then I'm going to train up against it. I can do the same thing again using deep learning for J, and the code will be much, much shorter than writing everything by hand, where all the math and everything that I want to do for each of those nodes, I'm working out by hand. Whereas here I've got a neural network engine that's structure in layers, tell it what all the different layers do, and it goes and does the rest. So much less code. And if you put that together, you should be able to, so you'll be going, if you go and look at the MNIST GUI, you'll be able to run that. And what you should find is a little thing like that. Let me see whether it, yeah. Just, so what I've gone and done is ran the code that you saw before to predict my model. Then I've got this little GUI, and you come and draw on the GUI, and then you say predict, and it says that looks mostly like a 4 to me. Okay, so if I do a 3, but maybe not quite a 3, ask it to predict it, it's saying possibly a 5, possibly most likely a 3. If I go even a bit more or less clear and ask it, it's saying, oh, could be a 7 there, or could be, it's actually more likely a 7 than a 3 is what it's telling me. Or it might even be a 0. That's a poorly formed 0. It might even be a 9. It might be a 9 that's not quite closed. So you can go and what? Now that's interesting. That's more what I was expecting. So I've got 0.4 for a 1. And so it's actually, the numbers here aren't adding up to 1. So it's actually telling me that it might not even be a number. But if I do maybe something like that, that's telling me that's a 1. Okay. Do an almost 8. And that's telling me it's most likely an 8, possibly a 6, and all the others are very small. So you can if you're doing the, if you've got the GitHub repo, you'll be able to run that example. Otherwise, you'll have the natural language examples to run. Let me continue on, and then I'll let you play with those. Okay, so you'll have this one here as well, but this one takes a bit more setup to run, but I'll just show you what it looks like, and then you can decide if you want to try to get it all set up. So this is definitely not on the notebooks. All the code for this is in the repo, but you actually have to have MXNet installed, and it's a little bit tricky. It's a project that's going through incubation, and many people who would be using it and trying to get high speed happening would be looking at things like CUDA and using GPU computations, and that's all a bit fiddly to set up. But I've got it all set up just to use straight Java. But I had to use specific versions of MXNet to get it all working. So it should all work, but yep, Rich has come in. Yep, good turnout. Thanks, Rich. So it's all, you'll be, I think it'll run out of the box if you run it out of the repo. So that should be the good news. So this is the code. This is going to try to, you feed it in a test image, and you ask it to try to detect things that it's knows about, and you feed in some pre-built images that know about certain things. It knows about motorbikes, knows about bikes, knows about dogs and cars and so on. And then you ask it to try to predict things, and it'll come up with an answer, something like that. So this is a good one to go and play with. And you can go and tweak the different parameters for do I look for only small shapes? Do I look for really big shapes? Etc. There's a whole lot of parameters that you can tweak, and you'll get different results back. And I don't know whether I've Can show you. Yeah, so if I ask it, if I do a bit, actually shrink down the number of shapes and I shrink up the range of things to look for, it'll actually find the motorbike. It finds the car and it finds the bicycle twice, three times, and the dog once. So you can tweak around with the parameters and get it to do better or worse on certain things. But if you go overboard, then it can potentially look like this, which doesn't help very much because it's found a potted plant, a dining table, it's found the dog, and it's also found a horse, it's found a sofa. So this is some sort of sofa here as well as a dining table. It's found a bird in the tree somehow, still found the motorbike. I think it's got two bicycles. I don't know where the potted plant is, unless that's the edge of a potted plant or something. But anyway, this is a dining table here, apparently. And this is part of a sofa that you'd sit in and so on. So anyway, these models are not perfect. You'll see that even though it's coming up with weird stuff like sofas and horses and what have you, the confidence rating it's got for these are very much smaller. So the potted plant is very small. The bird is very small. Even the motorbike is very small because it's obstructed by the post in the tree. It's not 100% sure if that's a motorbike or not. And similarly for this sort of shape that's in here, that's sort of sofa-ish like, it's not very confident about those. So you've got to factor that in, but it's interesting to play around with these sorts of models. So you can go do that if you want. I don't normally show all those things, but I thought it might be interesting. Okay, and that was all of the slides. So we're on our last session. So that's the other stuff. What I'm going to give you now is about 20 minutes or so to do the classification examples. So you can either run that number little one if you've got the repo. If you're on the Jupyter notebooks, you'll have, I think the language classification is there. There's two or three examples that you can run at this point. So run those, and then we'll have one more wrap-up session where you can ask further questions. And otherwise, that'll be our session done. Just remember, all of the examples are in that repo. All the slides are there. If you've missed anything, there will be a recording. And I think it still says recording now. So I think we actually got through the whole of the session in recording. I thought it might cut out before we finish, but it looks like it's all going to be there. So I'll give you now 15, 20 minutes to do those examples, and then I'll just do a final farewell and say goodbye and thank everyone. But certainly ask me any questions. You can either ask questions in the chat or ask to come on stage if you want to do a video question. Okay. Thanks, everyone. I'll just let you beaver away for a little bit and see how you go. I'll check in a few minutes' time.